In the 4th century BC, the Greek philosopher Plato wrote of a hypothetical civilization isolated from the rest of the old world, with many modern historians interpreting this lost fictional land of Atlantis as a single landmass off the western coast of Africa and Europe in the Atlantic Ocean. Little did Plato know that this idealistic tropical paradise was closer to reality than he thought, not in the form of a lost island, but rather in a series of mostly geologically unrelated islands, archipelagos, and landmasses located along the west coast of the Old World that stretch as far as 1,200 miles out in the Atlantic, making it the closest thing geographically to Atlantis in the real world. This island chain is known as Macaronesia, a term you've probably never heard of, yet most likely you've heard of the island constituents of this region that are so heavily interconnected with large swaths of other chunks of the planet, and are of extreme significance from a geographic, historical, and anthropological view. Today we're going to discuss some of the ancient human history on these islands, which stretches back far more than most would anticipate, as well as the more recent history of colonialism and exploration that helped shape our planet and lead to our modern interconnected age. Essentially, Macaronesia is divided into dozens of islands that are grouped together in certain island clusters that belong to the three countries of Portugal, Spain, and Cape Verde, with the northernmost clusters of Azores and Madeira being autonomous regions of Portugal, the Canary Islands south of that being an autonomous community of Spain, and Cape Verde a few hundred miles south of that being an independent country since 1975. Macaronesia is unique for several reasons, with one of the most noteworthy being its demographic makeup, which, because of its position and history, makes it a somewhat artificial transition zone that would have otherwise been impossible to manifest prior to the mass migration brought about by the European colonial era. As I've mentioned many times before on this channel, North Africans have one of the most diverse gene pools of any single region. However, by and large, the majority of North Africans are of Southwest Eurasian ancestry, with varying degrees of Sub-Saharan African input from archaic and more recent intermingling, and the predominant ethnic macro group of Northwest Africa before the arrival of the Romans, Phoenicians, or Arabs were, of course, the Berber or Amazigh people. These Amazigh from the Maghreb were possibly the first humans in history to have inhabited any section of Macaronesia, settling in the Canary Islands some 3,000 years ago, and became known to the Spaniards as the Guanches. And although not too much is known of their language or culture, it is clear that they were speakers of an Afro-Asiatic language belonging to the same gene pool as other ancient Maghrebis, as evidenced by the predominance of E3B2 in the native Canarian population, and their appearance had been described and observed to be quite similar to that of other Berber groups, such as the Kabyle, with a somewhat dusky complexion, although similar to the Kabyle, light eyes and hair were not uncommon among this group, and they were also described as exceptionally tall, and hence ancient connection with Proto-European peoples are not out of the question, despite the more recent linguistic links to other North Africans. Because of their distance from the mainland of Afro-Eurasia, the other island chains of Macaronesia were completely uninhabited for the vast majority of their history, making the Canary Islands the only island chain of the region to have an ancient indigenous population. However, this doesn't necessarily make the other islands of any less historical significance. Various historical powers, including the Greeks, Phoenicians, and Romans, were aware of the existence of the Canary Islands and may have partially explored them, although Macaronesia eventually became deeply linked to the peninsula of Iberia in southwest Europe, rather than the far closer region of North Africa. Now, unlike the mainland of the Maghreb to their east, the Canary Islands were never conquered by either the Romans or Islamic Arab armies, and despite the entirety of the North African peoples gradually converting to Islam, the Canarians retained their traditional paganistic faith, although a few Arab explorers did visit and attempt to establish relations. The demographics of the Canary Islands radically changed around the 15th century AD when Western Europeans began to thoroughly explore the northwest coast of the continent of Africa, with one of the first explorers to reach the Canaries being Lancelotto Malocello in 1312, who was actually Genoese, same as Christopher Columbus. The Reconquista of Iberia by Spain and Portugal no doubt emboldened these two to become major world powers, and the Castilians began their conquest of the Canaries shortly after contact was established, with the islands falling under Castilian rule at the beginning of the 15th century when the Kingdom of the Canary Islands became a vassal of the Spanish Empire. Large numbers of immigrants from the mainland of Spain, especially Andalusia, thus began to flood the islands, and intermarriage, almost exclusively between Spanish men and Guanche women, became quite commonplace. So much so, in fact, that the native population of the Canaries was completely absorbed into the new Hispanicized culture within less than 3 centuries, as the last of the Guanche language went extinct in the 17th century. Smaller numbers of Sephardic Jews and Spanish Moriscos, or Muslims, also came to the islands during this time, while also being absorbed into the new gene pool. So, in a way, the Canarians were the precedent for the future of Latin America's hybrid population. The bulk of the inhabitants of the Canary Islands today still consider themselves to be Spaniards, although clearly they do have additional admixture from the previous Amazigh-like population at rates of 10% to sometimes even 40% at the very highest, with an average of perhaps somewhere in the upper teens. The Canaries also have an important diaspora that is difficult to enumerate, yet has impacted many regions of the Americas, especially Caribbean nations such as Cuba, the Dominican Republic, and Puerto Rico. And in fact, Caribbean Spanish has actually been described by many Latin Americans and mainland Spaniards as having a distinct connection to Canarian Spanish. The other island chains in Macaronesia have slightly less exciting histories, as the Azores, which literally lie in the middle of the Atlantic, were actually discovered by accident by Portuguese explorers during a storm in the early 15th century, while the Cape Verde archipelago was discovered a few decades after that by the Portuguese. Small numbers of Portuguese from the mainland settled in Azores and Madeira, although the islands were far more pivotal as resupply stations in the middle of the Atlantic, which proved useful in traveling to Africa, the Americas, and beyond. And even though African slavery was uncommon in the region of Madeira, Azores, and the Canary Islands, there are small amounts of sub-Saharan African admixture, even when excluding the trace of naturally occurring African DNA already found in southern Europeans at rates of 0 to 3%. Cape Verde is distinguished from the other island chains demographically, as slavery was commonplace in the islands, and intermixing over the centuries with European groups such as the Portuguese, Italian, Spanish, and even Arabs and Jews created this new hybrid ethnicity known as Cape Verdean Creoles. Therefore, it can be concluded that Cape Verdeans are an artificial, albeit fascinating, transitional region in terms of human genetics and geography between the region of Iberia and southern Europe and West Africa, which actually bypasses all of North Africa, which otherwise serves as the intermediate demographic transition zone between these two, although similar to any recently mixed population, appearance and genetics is highly variable by region. At the upper end of the spectrum, Cape Verdean Creoles may contain as much as 60 to 70% European DNA, or vice versa, with the bulk of their European ancestry of Portuguese origin, while the bulk of their African ancestry comes from the Wolof and Fulani peoples of neighboring Senegal. In Cape Verde today, the majority, over 70% of inhabitants, are of mixed Creole ancestry, while there does exist a very large minority of more recent unmixed African immigrants, as well as a much smaller number of unmixed Portuguese who remained on the islands after the independence of Cape Verde. Now, interestingly, for the most part, the migration patterns of Cape Verdean Creoles has long mirrored, and in some cases even matched that of early Portuguese immigrants, no doubt reflecting their shared language, heritage, and similar geographic spread, as well as the desire for people groups as a whole to settle in a community of similar and like-minded people, as certainly Cape Verdean Creoles still have more in common culturally and genetically with the ethnic Portuguese or Luso-Brazilians in the present day than any other group on the planet. This is evidenced by the fact that the bulk of Cape Verdean immigrants to the United States have actually settled in the New England area of the Northeast, especially Connecticut, Massachusetts, and Rhode Island, which are also the states with the 3 largest Portuguese communities in North America. And in fact, Portuguese remains the 3rd most common first spoken language in the latter states at nearly 4%. This has caused a small deal of confusion in the region, which up until quite recently, as in the 1980s, remained one of the most racially homogeneous areas of the United States, albeit with already established Black American communities in large cities, and the multiracial Cape Verdeans did not fit into any of the established racial categories, and hence many Cape Verdean Americans today may check off the boxes for African American, some other race, or multiracial. Now, by compiling a plethora of genetic studies and anecdotes, we come to the conclusion that around 52% of the Cape Verdean Creole gene pool is of African origin, 42% of European origin, with another 6% of Middle Eastern, North African, or Jewish extraction. For Canarians, the ratio is around 77% European, 19% Middle Eastern or North African, and only 4% Sub-Saharan African, while those from Madeira and the Azores are overwhelmingly European in origin, with relatively little African or Middle Eastern admixture when compared to the former two groups. So, in conclusion, although the region of Macaronesia does lack a uniform identity or gene pool that would otherwise define a demographic region of the planet, they do have similar histories in their relation to Iberia, the Maghreb, and West Africa, and create quite the unique genetic and demographic landscape. So please tell me your thoughts on the history of these islands, and for today's poll, tell me which Macaronesian island chain you find the most fascinating. And as always, thank you all for watching. This has been Mason. And I'll see you next time.